Hachette Audio presents First Family, written by David Baldacci and read by Ron McLarty. Prologue. Her footsteps were unhurried. Down the street, making one left, a two-block straightaway, and then a slight right. There was a pause at one intersection, a longer stop at another, just from habit, really. The radar in her head showed no danger, and her pace picked up. There were people around, though the hour was late, but they never saw her. She seemed to ease by like a breeze, felt, but never seen. The three-story cinder block building was right where it had always been, stuck between a high-rise on the left and a concrete shell on the right. There was security, of course, but it was basic, not the best. A typical package. It would slow down a journeyman for a few minutes, a pro for much less. She selected a window in the back of the building instead of breaking in the front door. These entry points were almost never wired. She popped the swivel latch, slid up the window, and wriggled through. The motion detector was handled with ease. She was humming as she did it. Yet it was a nervous hum. She was getting close to it. What she was here for. And it scared the hell out of the lady. Not that she would ever admit that. The file cabinet was locked. She cracked a smile. "You're really making me work here, Horatio." 5 seconds later, the drawer slid open. Her fingers skimmed over the file tabs, alphabetical, which left her smack in the middle of the pack, something she'd never considered herself to be. Her fingers stopped skipping and curled around the file. It was a thick one. She'd never doubted it would be. She obviously wasn't a mere 10-page head case. A lot more trees had fallen because of her. She pulled it free and glanced at the copier on the work table. "Okay, here we go." Horatio Barnes was her shrink, her mind guru. He'd convinced her to enter a psych hospital a while back. The only mystery that voluntary incarceration had solved was one that did not involve her problems at all. Later, good old Horatio had hypnotized her, taking her back to her childhood, as any shrink worth his sheepskin invariably does. The session apparently had revealed many things. The only problem was that Horatio had decided not to fill her in on what she'd told him. She was here to correct that little oversight. She slid the pages in the feeder and hit the button. One by one, the events of her life whooshed through the heart of the Xerox machine. As each fresh piece of paper was catapulted into the catch bin, her heart rate seemed to increase by the same single-digit measure. She put the original file back in the drawer, popped a rubber band around her copy, and held it in both hands. Constituting only a few pounds, its weight still threatened to sink her through the floor. Out the same way, her boots made a clunking sound as they kissed asphalt. She walked calmly back to her SUV, a breeze again, invisible. Nightlife going on all around here. They never saw her. She climbed in her ride, revved the engine. She was ready to go. Her hands played over the steering wheel. She wanted to drive, always loved to rip her eight cylinders down some new road to where she didn't know. And looking through the windshield, she didn't want new. She desperately wanted things to be the way they were. She glanced at the file, saw the name on the first page, Michelle Maxwell. For a moment, it didn't seem to be her. In those pages was someone else's life, secrets, torments. Issues. The dreaded word. It seemed so innocuous. Issues. Everyone had issues. Yet those six letters had always seemed to define her, breaking her down into some simple formula that still no one seemed capable of understanding. The SUV idled, kicking carbon into an atmosphere already bloated with it. A few raindrops smacked her windshield. She could see people start to pick up their step as they sensed the approaching downpour. A minute later, it hit. She felt the wind buffet her sturdy SUV. A spear of lightning was followed by a long burp of thunder. The storm's intensity forecast its brevity. Such violence could not be sustained for long. It used up too much energy far too fast. She couldn't help herself. She cut the engine, picked up the pages, ripped off the rubber band, and started to read. General info came first. Birth date, gender, education, and employment. She turned the page, and then another. Nothing she didn't know already. Not surprising, considering this was all about her. On the fifth page of typed notes, her hands began to tremble. The heading was Childhood, Tennessee. She swallowed once and then again, but couldn't clear the dryness. She coughed and then hacked, but that only made it worse. The swells of saliva had solidified in her mouth, just like they had when she'd nearly killed herself on the water, rowing to an Olympic silver medal that meant less and less to her with each passing day. She grabbed a bottle of G2 and poured it down her throat, some of it spilling on the seat and the pages. She cursed, scrubbed at the paper, trying to dry it, and then it tore, nearly in half. This made tears creep to her eyes. She was not sure why. She pulled the rent paper close to her face, though her eyesight was perfect. Perfect, but she still couldn't read the script. She looked out the windshield and couldn't see anything there either. So hard was the fall of rain. The streets were empty now, the people having scattered at the first bite of water, bent nearly horizontal by the wind. She looked back at the pages, but there was nothing there either. The words were there, of course, but she couldn't see them. "You can do this, Michelle. You can handle this." Her words were low, sounded forced, hollow. She refocused. "Childhood, Tennessee," she began. She was 6 years old again and living in Tennessee with her mother and father. Her dad was a police officer on the way up. Her mom was, well, her mom. Her four older brothers had grown and gone. It was just little Michelle left at home, with them. She was doing fine now. The words were clear. Her memories also crystallizing as she crept back to that isolated wedge of personal history. When she turned the page and her gaze flickered over the date on the top, it was as though the lightning outside had somehow grounded right into her. A billion volts of pain, a shriek of anguish you could actually see and feel as it pierced her. She looked out the window. She didn't know why. The streets were still empty, the rain now racing to earth so hard the drops seemed to be connected, like trillions of strings of beads. Yet as she squinted through the downpour, she saw that the streets weren't empty. The tall man stood there. No umbrella, no overcoat. He was soaked right through. His shirt and pants melted to his skin. He stared at her, and she did the same right back. There was not fear or hatred or sympathy in his look as he eyed her through the walls of water. It was, she finally concluded, an underlying sadness that easily matched her own despair. She turned the key, put the SUV in drive, and hit the gas. As she raced past, she glanced at him as another thrust of lightning cracked and briefly made night into day. Both their images seemed solidified in that blast of energy, each of their gazes frozen onto the other. Sean King never attempted to speak and didn't try to stop her as she roared by. He just stood there, his waterlogged hair in his face. Yet his eyes, as big and invasive as ever she'd seen them, they frightened her. They seemed to want to pull her soul right out of her. An instant later, he was gone as she turned the corner and slowed. Her window came down. The bundle of pages was hurled out, landing squarely in a dumpster. A moment later, Her SUV was lost in the punishing face of the storm. Chapter 1. Birthday balloons and submachine guns, elegant forks digging into creamy goodies while toughened fingers coiled around curved metal trigger guards.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.